Before showing the design, numbers and experiments, I want to explain why I am doing all this at all. Here I want to explain why I'm so focused on air purification. We are used to talking about smells, but the problem goes much deeper. Air pollution worldwide is no joke anymore. We smell smoke from a campfire, but we don't feel the invisible killers. Microscopic PM, 2.5 particles that penetrate the lungs and bloodstream, formaldehyde from passing cars, or nitrogen dioxide from power plants. And every year, the situation only gets worse. Energy demand is rising in many countries. I used to think green energy was the future, but in reality it accounts for only 2-3%. The backbone of electricity production is still coal, heavy fuel oil, and gas, as you can see in this chart. The only drop in energy consumption happened during the 2009 crisis and COVID lockdowns. The rest of the time, consumption grows almost exponentially. I've measured air quality on my balcony many times, and it's never within normal limits. Look at PM2.5. In the distance, you can see haze. Look at ventilation grills. They're black from smog, and that's what we breathe. According to official statistics, 50,000 people die every year in Poland alone due to air pollution. That's like a small city disappearing from the map annually. I checked the global air quality monitoring map, and it's terrifying. There are almost no places left where air quality is in the green zone. It's either dangerous or critically dangerous. So filtration is no longer a luxury, it's a necessity. Today I want to show you a new stage in the evolution of my heat recovery ventilator. I've been passionate about this project for 6 years now. That's when my very first video was released. The development of this specific new version has taken the last 2 years. I've come a long way. From very simple and inefficient designs to a model with an aluminum tube heat exchanger. It was a breakthrough at the time, but it had two serious drawbacks. Very low airflow, only 25 cubic meters per hour, and not particularly high efficiency. And efficiency, the heat recovery efficiency, is the key parameter of any recuperator. In the early versions, it was only 55%. With the tubular aluminum model, I achieved 71% at minimum power, but as airflow increased, efficiency dropped to 62%. 62% efficiency was clearly not enough. I had to move forward, but to go further, this system needed more than just better mechanics. It needed a brain. Of course, a system like this needs brains, not just manual adjustment with a potentiometer. A monitor uses sensors to analyze the air directly inside the room and automatically decides which operating mode the recuperator should use to achieve the best air quality. This fundamentally distinguishes it from traditional centralized systems. Those systems are usually installed somewhere on the roof and simply push massive amounts of air through the entire house, regardless of whether a specific room actually needs it. The result is enormous power consumption, bulky equipment, and, most importantly, thick air ducts that consume 20-30 cm of ceiling height. My approach is decentralized. One smart recuperator per room. It's far more efficient, easier to install, and significantly cheaper. For comparison, centralized systems often cost around $10,000, and installation can cost just as much. My solution will be tens of times cheaper. To bring this idea to life, I combined it with something I've been developing for a long time, my own air quality monitor. The solution was obvious. Merge them, so automation can analyze the air and control the recuperator automatically. But the path was, to put it mildly, difficult. My first prototype, built on the knee, constantly glitched due to a tangled mess of floating wires. The second version was more stable, but the components picked up electromagnetic interference like antennas. Some sensors went crazy and started producing random values, literally from outer space. No matter how carefully I soldered it, the readings were unreliable. I realized I had reached the limit of my DIY methods. The only correct solution was to design my own PCB. That idea always scared me. I imagined complex chemical processes, acid etching, expensive equipment, something for large corporations, not a home workshop. But I decided to at least try to understand it. It turned out, everything had changed. After watching just a couple of YouTube tutorials, I realized I'd been afraid for nothing. Modern software does almost all the hard work for you. You draw the schematic like a Lego set, place components on a virtual board, and the software helps you route all the traces. I saved the file in Gerber format, opened a PCB manufacturer's website, and uploaded it there. When I saw the price, around $5 for a batch of boards, I thought it had to be a mistake, but I decided to take the risk. A week later, a package arrived, and inside was my board, factory made, perfectly flat, and professional. You can't imagine how satisfying it is to move from a constantly glitching wire mess to this result. It opens completely new horizons for me. Now I can build much more complex, and most importantly, reliable devices, without worrying about a loose wire somewhere. Thanks to PCBDway for their assistance. My first thought was simple. Bigger means better. I used tubes twice as long, 1 meter instead of 50 centimeters, and increased their diameter. In theory, this should have improved both efficiency and airflow capacity. I tested it, and almost nothing changed. Airflow stayed the same, and efficiency didn't improve either. Alright, moving on. I decided to drastically increase the air duct diameter from 100 to 150 millimeters. The housing became almost twice as heavy. I ran the tests, and once again, disappointment. Yes, airflow doubled, but at the cost of very high noise caused by air rushing through the tubes. Efficiency increased only slightly to 66%. At that point, I realized I had hit a wall. Further scaling of the tubular heat exchanger simply made no sense. Then came the idea that changed everything, using a plate heat exchanger. I looked at how well-known manufacturers do it, and was surprised. Many of them use ordinary polycarbonate. It's cheap and easy to work with. I cut the sheets, 3D printed cassettes to hold them at the correct angle, so the airflows move toward each other without mixing, assembled everything and turned it on. Air flows through the plates much more easily than through tubes. That's a fact, but the efficiency was terrible, only 40%. And that's logical. The thermal conductivity of plastic is just 0.2 watts per meter Kelvin, while aluminum is around 220, 1,000 times higher. For comparison, copper is almost 2,000 times better than plastic. The plate concept was correct, but the material wasn't. I decided to build the heat exchanger from aluminum. I made tooling to bend the plates, and on the opposite side I decided to use a vapor permeable membrane. This was supposed to solve one of the main problems of most heat recovery systems, condensation, which reduces indoor humidity. The membrane returns moisture back into the room and, in theory, should also increase efficiency. I assembled everything, turned it on, and the result was as bad as it gets. Due to the DIY assembly, high-pressure air found weak contact points and mixed between channels. Look at this. Only one fan is running, yet there's a strong airflow coming from the other channel. That should never happen. It turned out that airtightness is the hardest part of building such a device. That's probably why manufacturers like polycarbonate so much. It's much easier to seal. I didn't give up. I bought thicker aluminum with an adhesive layer so the membrane would bond tightly. I made new bending, tooling with deeper channels, reassembled everything, and still had leaks. It took me several days to seal every gap in the heat exchanger and cover all possible leakage points. Air flows through this system under high pressure, and even a tiny gap can let a huge amount of air through. Eventually, I finally achieved complete airtightness. And only then was I able to run the final tests. And the results made me happy. Efficiency didn't increase further, but it became stable. 73 to 75% across the entire operating range. Here I want to make an important note about numbers. You often see small recuperators advertised with 90% or even 98% efficiency. But there's a huge difference between laboratory tests and real life. Such numbers are usually obtained on test benches, under ideal, insulated conditions, at minimum speed, with no wind load, and with artificial heating that only simulates outdoor temperature. In real conditions, such units usually deliver only 50 to 60% at best. My 73 to 75% is real operating efficiency. These are honest numbers the system delivers here and now. I'm now switching to copper plates. But copper is a very demanding material. My first attempts to bend it by hand resulted only in wasted material. It's extremely difficult to achieve tight contact, and without it, air will mix inside the channels. To achieve perfect geometry and repeatability, I'm developing a dedicated forming machine. Even with imperfect assembly, I managed to reach 90% efficiency at medium power, which is incredible for systems like this. And of course, filters. Instead of guessing, I built a dedicated test rig and tested everything I could find, from basic filters to a gas mask filter. The conclusion was clear. The best result comes not from a single super filter, but from a combination. For the final version, I chose a combination of HEPA13 and a TiO2 photocatalytic filter. When exposed to ultraviolet light, it effectively destroys bacteria and viruses. It also had a carbon layer, but honestly, there was almost no carbon in it. Later, I'll definitely add a proper carbon filter with replaceable granules. I ran the test in my bathroom, filling it with smoke to the maximum and running the fan at full power. The suction was so strong that it literally pressed plastic film into the bathtub. The result? PM2.5 particles are filtered at 99.5%. I haven't tested bacterial destruction yet, simply because I currently have no way to measure it. I'll look for a laboratory later, but VOC pollution turned out to be in the danger zone, precisely because of that useless carbon filter. The work isn't finished. What's next? First, thermal insulation of the heat exchanger. This will further increase efficiency and reduce noise. The ideal candidate is aerogel, an incredible material that's 99% air. Its thermal conductivity is almost the same as air itself, and far superior to foam. Just look at a gas burner test, and everything becomes clear. Second, noise. People often ask why I don't use quiet inline fans. The answer is simple. They have low static pressure. They can't push air through such a powerful filtration system. That's why I use centrifugal blower type fans. To reduce noise, I'll add vibration isolation, install a duct silencer, and aerogel itself will also contribute. Conclusion. As you can see, this has been a long journey, from a simple idea to a complex engineering system. Development is still in full swing, but I wanted to share these intermediate results with you. Thank you for watching.